officially live broadcasting only on onedealaway.com. This is Money Matters. My name is Nav, and today we have an episode, right? Today we're going to be talking a lot about continuing our conversation about real estate, because there was a lot of stuff to cover yesterday that we didn't cover. For example, one of the things that we left it on that I promised I was going to cover this morning, and that is exactly what we're going to do, is this one loan program that exists that is so much simpler to utilize and borrow on that vast majority of individuals don't even know about or utilize. You can't use it if you're going straight in the center of the town, but anywhere else, or just about anywhere else, it will work, and it will probably give you better rates, better terms, less hassle, and it's going to be way better for you to get in to a property, to get started, and so it works for land, it works for single family, it works for multifamily. So it has multiple works about it, which is super exciting for me. We're going to be taking a look into that stuff. We're going to be talking about why you might find yourself that you might need a co-signer for things. You're like, wait a minute, I'm an adult, this is embarrassing. Why do I need a co-signer to rent or buy? We're going to be covering those things as well. We're going to be talking about some of the affordable lake towns, water property, that you might be interested in. We did promise yesterday, but I promised to get it done today because we just ran out of time, of where do the incumbents, so to speak, the two individuals that are battling for the white throne, of where do they stand when it comes to mortgage. And we're going to be looking at some lot sizes and some tech companies and what does that all mean for real estate, where are they going, what are they doing, and what the wealth is around the world, or the GDP that has dropped around the nation. So much stuff to cover, it's not even funny. So without further ado, let's do this. And I'm back. I had to go get some coffee. Hopefully you have some coffee as well. I do want to welcome everybody watching this live on onedealaway.com/live. And of course, if you're watching live, make sure you say hello, sign in, say hello. We're going to do Q&A at the end of the show, as always. If you're watching this on Facebook, YouTube, wherever else that you might find it, specifically probably YouTube, because that's my primary vehicle of where these puppies go. Do me a huge favor, smash the like button, do subscribe, hit the bell button, you get notified every time we go live and chat. And of course, chat we shall. This is the promise that I made yesterday, so that is exactly where we're going to go today. So, moving into the country, this Overlook Loans makes it so easy. And when we say moving into the country, it doesn't mean you gotta go to the boonies, okay? I just wanna put it out there. I wanna be very clear. We're gonna debunk this whole thing. This is gonna be fun. So, many city dwellers may be considering a move to the country, where there's a specific type of mortgage that can help make this a reality called USDA loan. It is designed to help buyers with moderate to low income purchase property outside cities, low or no down payment, and looser qualification for income and credit history. So this is the sort of benefits about it. But here's the things that you need to know. You don't have to buy a house in the boonies, as I have said. Homes qualify as long as they're located outside a metropolitan area. In fact, communities with population of up to 35,000 may be fine. You don't have to be a destitute, and income limits recently increased. So to qualify for USDA, of course, it's for lower income folks. So if you're making, $500,000 to $1 million a year, congrats to you. You probably won't qualify for this one. But if you are a normal, mere mortal, as they call it, the normal mortal, you will likely qualify. And we're going to take a look at what that means. People think USDA loans means that to be subsidized housing, or that they are only intended for use by by those with very low income. There are actually two types of USDA loans. Direct housing loans are for low-income individuals, and guaranteed loans are designed for moderate-income buyers. In most locations, the income limit for households with one to four people is $90,300. So as you can see, if you are a solo person and you are making $90,000 or less, which qualifies so many people out there, you can actually utilize this particular loan to get into a house. And of course, you can't do it in a center of a city. So like if you are wanting to buy, $5 million one-bedroom condo in downtown New York City, because, okay, they're not $5 million, they're two, okay, fair. You probably won't get qualified for USDA, but if you decide to, go somewhere a bit more rural, and we're going to look at what rural means in a moment, then this could potentially work for you. USDA loans are easier to get than ever. The specification vary by lender. Borrowers typically need a minimum credit score of 640, whereas other ones require 700 or higher. So even if you have slightly lower credit score, you can actually get into it. So less hassle, less regulation, more favorable rates. It gets even better. They aren't just for first-time buyers, so it only allows a borrower to own one property. USDA only allows a borrower to own one property at a time, so using USDA loan program allows for additional purchases in the future as long as the current home is sold or will be sold prior to closing on the new one. So here's the piece: you can't use this to qualify for multiple homes, but if you're just getting started, this could very well work. Or a potential thing to look at is that if it's you and a partner, you own one property, they can go and probably qualify for another property. So you definitely want to take a look into that stuff as well. That could work as well. USDA loans have great interest rates. So whereas right now we are at mid to high twos, right? I was going to say 20s. I'm like, whoa, no, Nev, no, that's 1980s. So we're about 3%, 2.something to 3%. The rates for USDA loans are a bit lower. As of September, rate single family housing direct home loans are 2.5 for low and very low income borrowers. So you can get a bit lower income or the lower interest when buying with these, which is very, very cool. And they carry very few added costs. Certain USDA loans offer 100% financing with no down payment, which is, could be very, very welcome news. One piece of advice to really pay attention to is that if you decide to go for something that is no money down, make sure you actually do still have some money, because it can be very, very risky if you have literally zero money ready to go in buying a house. If you've ever owned a property, you know that if things can go wrong, they do go wrong. And so if you have a little bit of money set aside when things do go wrong, you actually have a little bit of money to make it happen. And also understand that when you go with 100% financing, right, which has its times and place and benefits, I fully agree with it. You also want to be very, very careful with this whole component, because it takes a while for you to get some equity, which means that refinancing gets a bit, it will take a while longer. So, unless we grow, 7 to 15% a year for like 3-4 years, at which point you're set, you can refi in a couple of years. Don't count on that. So, even if it's a flat or, grows up only 3% and stuff, it's going to be a while before you can refi. I'm not saying you want to, I'm just saying, if USDA is your way to kind of get, just something to be mindful of. And then, of course, USDA loan programs are providing all kinds of different loans and businesses for the rural businesses. So if you are thinking of providing or getting into a business that is a bit more rural kind of business, you can definitely, you know, USDA might be a place to go. So now we're going to take a look at what does that actually look like. So here we go. We are on their website, and I went in to see the property eligibility, right? And here is basically what it will look like. And let's just come in right over here. So you will see that that this like yellowish whatever area is not acceptable, right? So for example, if we are here in New York, right, you will see that just about all of New York City and around it and stuff is not acceptable. But there are parts of Long Island, right over here, that is acceptable, right? The same thing goes, for example, this is going to be, I think, Connecticut, right over here. So you will see that a big part over here is not, but like this area over here is very much acceptable. So you can see, we can play around, let's go up towards Boston. So you can see that, you know, a lot of things around Boston are not acceptable, right? But when you go a little bit further out, then it is very, very acceptable to have it. So you just want to play around with the map to understand of where you could or could not utilize USDA. And we don't even have to stick with the East Coast, right? We can actually go, let's see, you know. All right, let's take a look, for example, you know, Texas. So you will see most of the major metropolis, you know, you can't use USDA. Everything else you could. So for example, right, let's go look at Dallas, right? Dallas-Fort Worth. Well, this area you really can't, right? A lot of the areas, but so like if you were looking at Lancaster or Hutchins, you can't. But Red Oak, there are areas where you could, or Ferris, you probably could. Or Combine, or Forney, or Grand, right? You get the point. So you could get, if you wanted to go just sort of slightly out, and of course, if you want to go into the boonies, whatever the boonies are, I don't know, probably depend from person to person. Let's take a look at, you know, for example, Southern California, right? So of course, vast majority of this whole LA and stuff is covered, but when we come over here and zoom in, you see that there are parts of when you go north of Ventura, even toward on the coast and stuff, there are areas where it's perfectly fine. Then you hit Santa Barbara and Mission Canyon, and then it's not okay. And you know, you will see that it's just sort of like in and out, but there are definitely areas where you can qualify to buy. So make sure you play around with it. You know, Oregon, same thing. You know, you will see that basically Medford, as you can see, Medford is highlighted, Grand Pass. So like any larger town, it's a no-go. And then anything smaller than that, it's perfectly fine. So if you were, for example, let's see. All right, so Beaver Creek, for example, in Oregon City, qualified, but can't be in Molino, don't qualify for USDA. But the other ones do. So anyways, feel free to play around with it. You can also look at the rural business and see what programs they offer. You can look at multifamily, different guidelines, income limits. So there are income limits that exist that are basically follow on the number of people and of course per state. So for example, if you're in Nebraska, you can click on it and see what qualifies as very low income, moderate income, and so on. So that's an option, right? You can learn about loan basics. All right, this is pulling up multifamily housing, but you can read more about it. It's very, very cool, very interesting. So I do highly recommend that you do that piece. Now that we cover that stuff, one of the pieces that you might be wondering is that, you know, you're going out there, you're renting the properties, and, you know, you're looking at buying the stuff. And while you were in college, it kind of made sense that mom and dad had to co-sign for it, or maybe grandpa or, you know, uncle or whomever. Somebody had to co-sign for it. And when you got a first job, you're like, oh, man, I just moved to San Francisco. It's very expensive. So, yeah, they got to co-sign and I get it. But now you're like in your 30s and you're looking for a rental or whatever, and you still have to go and get cosigner. Why? So this article actually talks about this stuff that says why I'm grown up and employed but still need mom to cosign on my home. This is an interesting one, and I think it's very, very funny. And so it's a cute little story. It's super, super long. You don't have to worry about, I mean, we're not going to read the whole thing. But one of the things that people are saying, like, wait a minute, why does this happen to me? Well, part of it is that landlords, just like banks, have very strict requirements, and vast majority of landlords do require a 3 times your income to cover the rent. So if the rent is $1,000 a month, you need to bring home $3,000 a month in order to basically get it. So whenever that is not necessarily the case, a lot of times the landlords will actually require for you to bring a cosigner. Sometimes if your credit score, for example, is not as stellar, they will also require a cosigner, somebody has a bit better credit for it. This is not, atypical. It's very normal, it's very typical, and the reason that folks are doing it is because they want to get paid. So that's the biggest reason of why that's happening. Now, of course, a lot of times the twice the income will actually work for folks because, you know, they're saying, well, wait a minute, you know, I can cover my rent, you know, for $1,000, and I still have $1,000 to pay the bills. For me, as a landlord, I get a bit nervous about when people do that because I'm thinking, well, that's fine. You cover the rent for $1,000, that leaves you with $1,000, you know, left for bills. Well, maybe you have student loans, maybe you have credit card bills. You know, you gotta pay for food, and say that food is like $250 a month, that leaves it with $750. Then there is the electric and the heat, right? That can get pretty expensive depending on like how much of the stuff you're using. Then you gotta pay for your car insurance, for your gas for your car. There's all these different expenses that creep up that makes it potentially very scary for me to rent it to somebody who might not necessarily be able to qualify for the stuff. So for me, I do really believe in the threes. You know, if it doesn't come exactly to three, but it's like pretty darn close, I can live with it. But for the most part, especially nowadays, that is a must. That is a must. It's not even negotiable. But it also comes to following the mortgage lenders. So mortgage lenders often use the guideline that the housing cost should be no more than 30% of the income, which is the same thing that I end up using as well. And that's where the 3 times the rule is a handy approximation based on those guidelines as well. And the problem is that the income hasn't kept up with the prices of, you know, real estate or prices of anything whatsoever. Like while they have gone up, they haven't gone up nearly as much as everything else has gone up, and that's a huge problem. But at the end of the day, they were like, well, people don't care, they just want to get paid. Well, yes and no, because I don't want to deal with the whole eviction thing. You have all the right intentions today, and then tomorrow, you know, it doesn't happen. So you can actually get in, and so, you know, the cosigner basically means that if the person getting the place cannot afford it for whatever reason, there is a backup option, which is always cool and always important in my humble opinion. So I think that that's kind of the way I look at it. So, but how do you get into the property without a cosigner? Well, you find something that fits within your budget, or, you know, if it's not that it's just a budget piece, it could be, like I said, it could be that it's a credit component as well. So the other piece that to take a look at is, you know, is it the fact that you are, your credit is not just as good, right? And if that is the case, then you want to take a look at what are the eligibility components and how do I improve my credit, right? Maybe side hustle, right? Maybe moving into a cheaper apartment to get in, maybe finding roommates to split the stuff. So there are multiple ways to kind of look into it, but if those are some of the ways that you can get away from the whole cosigner piece. And at the end of the day, you know, don't take it personally. It's just a layer of protection for the individual and for you. And if it's the credit, and it buys you time to build on your credit. So focus on building it, focus on improving it. There's nothing wrong with it. There's no shame to it. So, you know, don't use it as a shaming beast. It's just kind of how things work. And, you know, at some point you might not need it. And it's kind of cool to have somebody who's willing to co-sign. Hey, if you have somebody who wants to co-sign on my stuff, I'll take it any day of the week. They can ding their record, not mine. Just kidding. They ding both when they do that. They ding both. And if you are tipped to be a co-signer, make sure that it is somebody that you trust or that, you know, you can scare the living daylights out of, like your kid. Because, you know, you are on the hook if they don't follow through. You are on the hook. Please understand that. So don't just do it for just about anybody, please. So be very, very careful with that component. Okay, all right. So we discussed this piece. Now it's the time to take a look at, you know, what do Biden and Trumpster kind of think about the mortgage and finance and that kind of stuff. So let's talk about it. I promised this yesterday. We didn't cover it. Let's cover it today. We're doing a catch up today. Catch all day. Trump administration aims to return two giant mortgage finance companies, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, to private hands over the next couple of years. And Biden administration, in contrast, could be in no hurry to release the companies which the government has controlled since 2008. Instead, Democratic former Vice President Biden would focus on ways to use the companies to boost housing affordability and promote home ownership. So that's basically where they sit. The one would basically say, make this private and let it run, let the free market do its thing. The other one says, no, government still needs to control this puppy and for forever, and we got to get more people to own homes, which, you know, I don't know. Maybe they do, maybe they don't. We've had other presidents who have done stuff that says everybody must own homes. And then that led to a giant blow up in 2008, which is what led to these two entities to land on the government's balance sheets. The Biden camp argues that the Trump administration's approach would bring higher mortgage rates, but the Republicans say that the government should play a smaller role in backstopping the mortgage market and in any increase, and that any increase in rates would be minimal. So they're basically kind of going back and forth. This is basically, you know, this explains what Fannie and Freddie are. And then it just basically goes into the advertisement. So if you can think that, you know, there's more to the story, there really isn't. I personally was disappointed in it. Of why would you even put it out there if you literally have two words to say? But it was out there. And I thought that we should definitely talk about it, because it was out there, right? It was listed, so I figured we could talk about it. Bottom line, it doesn't really matter who goes in it. You know, the rates follow the 10-year bonds, treasury, so the sovereign bonds, and that's where the mortgage follows. So when those drop, mortgage drop, when they'll go up, mortgage goes up. And the government and, you know, even the Fed don't control the 10-year. They can control the overnight rate. They don't control anything else. They just hope that by controlling the overnight rate, that everything else will fall in place. But a lot of times the politics, the beliefs, the what you think is going to happen, all of those things play a huge role into what we can expect to see from the rates. And so you could have the overnight rate is at zero and 10 could go negative. And we've seen it go like real, in real terms, not nominative terms, in real terms go negative. And if you forget what that means, it means that a nominal basically means that, you know, you could see and the number is going to say 0.5% of the return on your money. But when you take out the inflation and all of this stuff, the real rate is that piece. And that in that case could be negative 1% or negative 0.5% or negative 10%. I don't know. So those are the pieces to kind of pay attention to. All right. So we don't know who's going to do what. And one way or the other, I think it's going to be just fine. I have a hard time believing that somebody like Trumpster, who is big on real estate, would do anything to harm it, right? And Biden, who the heck knows? Who the heck knows? But, you know, I think he wants to be seen as helping people. So we'll see. We'll see how it all works out. 10 affordable lake towns. 10 affordable lake towns to buy a waterfront property on. And this is coming out of Forbes. And as you know, sometimes Forbes does funny formatting. So you get this like really weird thing. But here's the list of most affordable lake towns where you can find a home that is either directly on the lake or close enough to get a great view. And when we talk about affordable, this is the part that you want to, this is a very loose term. Loose term, affordable. So here we go. Offerings vary by location. You'll likely find option for boating, fishing, and paddle. So here we go. Chestertown, New York. Median lake home price is $493,900. Located in Southern Adirondacks Lake with a home to just 515 residents. Hey, maybe USDA would qualify over here. Probably will. But at, you know, it's kind of hard to mean that it's the affordable, but affordable is like $500,000. So that's why I said, please be careful about the whole affordable piece. I think that that was a clickbait right there. Just my personal humble opinion. Branson, Missouri, price $444,900. $450,000 is basically. And they have Table Rock Lake, paddleboarding, kayaking, boating. Then you have Glen Arbor, Michigan. $390,000 is the median, which means you can probably find something for way less and way, way, way more. So then we have median lake home price of Chelan, Washington, or Chelan, at $550,000, which is only a three-hour drive east of Seattle. And, you know, on the lake, then we have Goldsboro, Pennsylvania, $371,500, Poconos Mountain Range. Now, this is the piece, the interesting one. So this one in Poconos makes sense, because entry level homes start at 155,000, you know, bedroom and stuff, and it goes on up, which is nice. But some of the other ones, like the starter basically is like, you know, $500,000. So you definitely want to be careful when you're looking at these things. Vermilion, Ohio, median lake home price is $557,800, and it's located on the south shore of Lake Erie. And they're basically saying that you can find some under 200 for big renovations and stuff. But, you know, if you want the water view, then 400 and up for sure. Wisconsin Dells, Wisconsin, price is $437,000. You would see, you would, many of us would consider potentially, I don't know, I'm not trying to offend anybody, but this would be probably considered boonies. And USDA probably could qualify here. But as you can see, the prices are still holding really, really, really nicely. So this is, you know, still $437,000, halfway between Minneapolis and Chicago. So it's not even that it's close to anything, like halfway to it. It's not like a 30-minute drive. It's a drive for it. But they're saying that you could find, you know, something that needs fixing starting in the 100,000 range. And, you know, then you can, if you go to condos, you can find something as low as 40 to 55,000, which, you know, could be interesting. But, you know, do remember you might have an HOA, which could then bring up that monthly cost to way, way, way higher. So never forget the HOA. That's for buyers and investors alike. Spirit Lake, Iowa, price $792,000. I'm like, wait, what? How is this affordable? How is this affordable? But they are saying that you could find a single family home right on the smaller lakes, on the smaller lakes for 100,000 range. But, you know, if you want to be on the larger lake bodies, then expect to pay more. And, you know, you can find something at 200, 300,000. So I don't know how the median, I guess there's so many million plus, 2 million plus dollar homes, that that's where the median comes in. So you want to be very careful looking at stuff. Eli, Minnesota, price is $604,900. And this is like, you know, basically way up in northern Minnesota, or Minnesota, that has beautiful lakes, unspoiled forests. So that could be an interesting one. Hot Springs Village, Arkansas. Now, this is an interesting one because it's the largest gated community. 26,000 acre census designated place, boasts 9 golf courses, dozens of restaurants, 14,000 residents, 11 lakes, and it's predominantly a retirement community. So hey, if you are looking to go over there, you can actually even find places that are in mid-100s, and you know, you can go and hang out with all of the goodies but the oldies, or oldies but the goodies. And here is one of the houses over featured on Hot Springs Village. In case you're interested, I thought it was very beautiful. This is definitely on the lake, located. You can see it right over there, right? It shows what the, you know, what it looks like. The price is only $168,000. It looks pretty gorgeous to me. So if you are of the elderly, or you don't mind hanging out with them, then this could be a spot. You know, and especially if you're looking something that is like rural, but still kind of developed, still has some people, but you know, anyways, I think that this is quite gorgeous. It's, you know, the plain side, but you can always update it, right? And of course, beautiful, beautiful, picturesque lakes and everything that you would want. And here you go. This is the one that is, but it's a condo, right? And it's currently selling for $168,000, 3-bedroom, 3-bathroom, 1,658 square feet. And it's last sold for $163,000 in 2008. So it doesn't appreciate as much. Right now it's off market. It's off market. So, you know, home value, who knows? Who knows? They're saying it's, you know, it depends whom you ask. You know, it's between 140 and 160, and I'm trying to see if, do we have anything, talks about neighborhood. All right, we're not, you know, we don't care. You know, schools are pretty okay, property history. It is actually listed for sale, and I don't know why they say it's off market. It is listed for sale. It was listed in August. Maybe it's off market because it already sold. Let's see. The taxes are ridiculously low. Let's see. Monthly payment. HOA. It's actually not bad at $69 a month. So, again, you are looking, if you wanted to buy something like this, you know, assuming 20% down, 2.84 interest rate. 30-year fix, you're looking at $785 a month, plus minus. So not too shabby if you're interested in something like that. But of course, one of the things that has been very, very interesting to see is, you know, the whole concept of the, you know, homes as they're being built are actually getting smaller and smaller lots. And that is something that has been reported recently that I think it's important for us to understand. You know, many folks nowadays, you know, when you're going out there buying a home and, you know, new developments and that kind of stuff, because the zoning laws are allowing, and it depends from place to place, but allowing for more density, we're seeing that the lots on which the homes are built are getting smaller and smaller. So you might get a new build and the home is, you know, basically taking the entire property of the lot. New homes are being built on smaller lots. 0.188 of an acre, or 8,177 square feet, the smallest on record, is the median lot size for single family homes in 2019. And we're seeing this trend really pick up. Now, the median lot size in New England is 3 times as large as the national mean, mostly because we have strict local zoning regulations that require very low densities and require the lot sizes to be much bigger. So if you're looking for more space, New England will likely provide you with that stuff. And there are some rural areas that, like, you know, unless it's 5 acres or more, you can't subdivide it from that. But there are areas in other places where, you know, 5 acres, I mean, Lord knows, you can split that into like 20, 30 different lots and build. So you gotta be very familiar with the zoning laws if you're thinking into going into development and that kind of stuff, right? Not saying you should, I'm not saying you shouldn't, I'm just saying, you know, things to think about. The Pacific region, which includes California and Washington, tends to have higher densities and developed land is scarce. So, but you know, there is a lot of land over there as well. So don't be fooled by this article right here, because I will argue that there are lands out there that you can go out and develop potentially. I'm not saying do it, I'm just saying you could. And you can see that Pacific is like 0.15 acres, then Mountain is 0.17, and then as we get to the east, right, it gets bigger and bigger. Then we have right here, Central is like 0.16 and 0.2, then East North Central 0.23, 0.3 down south, 0.2, and then when we get into Middle Atlantic, which is, you know, Pennsylvania, New York, that kind of area is 0.3, and then New England, which is basically Vermont, Connecticut on east, is 0.6 and up. So as you can see, it does actually matter where you go. And so when we also, when we take a look at the prices of the homes, I think it's important for us to understand that, you know, it's not just the house, it's also the land. So a two bedroom, one bathroom home in New England is very different than two bedroom, one bathroom home in Arizona, for example, or California. Right here, we have things like attics that are usable spaces and basements that are usable spaces. Land sizes tend to be much, much larger. Then you go into a place like Arizona, for example, and there's really no such thing as basement, right? It's a slab and that's what you build on. So there's no basement, and there's no attic either, right? So it is what it is, and the lots tend to be much, much smaller. So I think all of those things should be accounted for when you're thinking and comparing, so that, you know, while all of it is fruit, you know, banana, apple, orange, and kiwi are all very, very different in look, in taste, in size, and, you know, in the likeness, right, of who likes what. Some people like all of them, some people couldn't stand any of them, and some people are very, very specific about any of these things, or potentially even allergic to some of them. So, one of the interesting pieces that I wanted to share with you today as well, since we're looking at the money and different components, is, you know, the economic drop. Since we were talking about the land size, I wanted to make sure that we share this stuff of where we are when it comes in the change in real GDP by state. And you can see everything is a sea of red. Everything is a sea of red. However, it's just a shade of red. The lighter the color, so the more pinkish it is, the less impact, negative impact it has. So for example, you know, Utah jumps in at only negative 22.4, and you can see that it's much lighter pink than most of the other ones, like Arizona nearby, or New Mexico that are down here. Sorry, this is Utah. Yes, Utah, this is Colorado. Sorry, my geography, you're testing me live. But you can see that it's much less. It's still a drastic drop, but it's less than the other ones around it. And then you have somewhere like Nevada, where it's like almost black, at negative 42, and then you have the reds, which are in the 30s and stuff. So you can take a look and see that just about everything has been hit, and you can see that three states really come up: Nevada, Tennessee, and Hawaii. And down here you can see the hardest hit industry by states, as well as the highest hit states in Hawaii, Nevada, and Alaska are being, really? Alaska is 33.8, Tennessee is 40, but somehow Alaska comes before, you know, and then they don't put Tennessee until much, much later. So interesting. Maybe that's because they're looking at specific industries that are hit, but I would say the top three looking at here, we have 42.2, Hawaii and Nevada sharing the same one. Then comes Tennessee at negative 40.4. And then come places like Alaska, and then, you know, at 33.48. But we see, for example, Pennsylvania and New York. I mean, New York is much higher ranked than Michigan and so on than even Alaska. So something very interesting to take a look into, that you want, you know, if you're interested in kind of where do you invest and where do pieces kind of make sense, you know, who's going to raise the taxes and where are the crazy things potentially going to happen. This could help us understand of where we are and what is going on and kind of where it makes sense to potentially invest, you can see that there are some states that have, you know, they have suffered, but not as greatly as the other ones. But you also want to not just focus on this stuff, you also want to look at research to understand which states are also poising themselves to benefit and improve as quickly as possible from the change of pace, from where they're going to go. And your money might be on California because of all of the tech. And because we're talking a lot of real estate, you know, might be thinking, well, wait a minute, you know, that might make sense. But maybe, maybe not. Here is the important article that we have received that I wanted to share with you, because it's important to understand where the direction of the business is going. About 3-4 months ago, I have done a video, standalone video, that I'm saying that people used to move to particular areas because of jobs, and that I think that that trend is going to shift. They're going to move for the quality of life, for the, you know, things that they really enjoy and believe in, whether it's a lot of space or beautiful mountains or whatever it is that they, you know, beaches or whatever it is that they want to move into. Sometimes it's, you know, preferable taxation and that kind of stuff. That we will see people do that stuff because more and more work is going to be remote. So now we have some news from the tech, from the Silicon Valley, of what does this actually mean? Are we going that direction or not? And so here we go. Let's get ready, and we're starting off with Twitter. And Twitter basically is the one that, you know, we know that they have shut down the campuses, asked employees to work from cases. Some are saying basically forever. Some are rethinking the spaces in order to prevent the spread, changing the plans, the real estate plans altogether to basically new type of office, no office, changing of who's getting paid and how and where they live, and all of these crazy, crazy new policies are coming in. So just wait till it all happens. So Twitter is the first one, and they have been wanting to do a decentralized workforce team for forever, and now they actually have an opportunity to do that. So they're ready to roll out. They have plans to in place for localizing pay based on where employees choose to live, and they're starting to already sublease their office space in San Francisco because they don't plan on coming back there ever. I am right there with Jack Dorsey. I believe that, yes, while a lot of things can be lost when not everybody's in the same place, if you organize and people kind of come together at that regard completely, and you organize the work groups in such a way where they're still virtually be able to work, I think you can still be very, very massively productive. And, there's something to be said about highly decentralized workforce where people are all over the globe working on stuff. It can be potentially challenging for some stuff, but super amazing for other things. I think it's just a strategic way of setting it up. And I've seen many companies doing that, being very, very successful in it. And I think Twitter will probably lead the way for the mass, tech guys as well here. Then we have Google, and Google is basically saying that, you know, not required to come until next summer. They are working to help the parents by giving extra time and offering extra money for the setup of the home offices. Facebook basically also helped with the money with the home offices. They expect that everybody will work remotely through June 2021. But some may, you know, they're saying you can also choose to do this forever if you want to. However, if you move out of the Bay Area and go somewhere less expensive, your pay cut will also follow suit. So that's an interesting piece that is kind of coming to play, which I find that is very, very interesting that is happening. I could see them doing it for the new employees, like, oh, okay, well, you plan to, you know, oh, you're going to live out of, you know, Montana, okay, well, the pay is this, like, this is the offer. But now it's an interesting piece where they're saying, well, oh, you're going to move to Montana. Well, I'm sorry, your price was $100,000, but now it's going to be $70,000. So have a good day. Thanks for playing. So this is going to be interesting. We'll see how employees will react and where this is all going to go. They did also assist with the extra time off for the parents, and of course home offices. Amazon is basically saying, hey, you can work remotely until January 2021. And as long as you can effectively work from home, and then after that, you know, we're going to be coming in with the, you know, physical distance and increased cleaning and temp checks and masks and all these different things. And you're going to be coming in. They're also helping with the, you know, parenting, with the childcare and that kind of stuff. And they are planning to expand physical locations and folks working in those areas. Salesforce is basically saying, eh, you know, we're going to open some offices, but not all. A lot of it is going to depend on where we are with the virus. You know, they're expanding benefits for the parents, and that's about it. But they're saying, you know, you're going to be coming to work. Slack announced that it would give employees option of how they can work, where they want to work. Office is going to look forever, change it of, you know, they're not going to have, you know, the meals and hangouts and that kind of stuff. So it's going to be focused a lot on the solo work, which you might as well then just work from home, right? So we'll see. All of this stuff is changing. What does this basically mean to me when I look at where they're all going? It basically means that, you know, the commercial space is going to go away unless it changes in the design and in the zoning and in the direction of what we're going to be doing. So if we are going to have largely electronic cars, that means we don't need gas stations. If we're going to basically have a fleet of cars that drive us around, we don't need parking garages unless it's for that fleet. If we're working largely predominantly from home, then our homes need to have gyms and offices, but we don't need office space, which means all of those office buildings now could be reworked into the housing components that have offices within it. But that is largely driven by the board, by the city, by the zoning, by the rules, by the regulations. And I think that that is going to be hugely, massively important. And to finish the show today, hopefully you have enjoyed it. Smash the like button before we go into the finishing round of it. Smash it right now. Let's do this, and let's take a look. So part of Washington's Mount Vernon estate is for sale for $60 million. And this is what $60 million will buy you. This is an absolutely beautiful kitchen. Hopefully you can see this. You know, I'm going to try to see if I can make it bigger. Maybe I can, maybe I can. But see, when I make it bigger, it just skews it over there. So you can't. It's a lose-lose. It's a lose-lose, I tell you what. Forbes, fix it. We've talked about it, man. We've talked about it. Okay. So, I mean, this is what it is. So if you have 100,000, sorry, 100,000, please. 60 million. You can have beautiful gardens, but better hire somebody to do this. Otherwise, all you will be doing is, tending to the gardens. So that's it. That's it. Hopefully you have enjoyed the show. Hopefully you have learned something new. Smash the like button, smash the subscribe button, and I will see you tomorrow if you do that. Well, we're going to talk, I don't know. Who knows? Let's see what happens, what news are. Probably going to be talking a little bit about crypto and the business and what's going on with the whole, like, you know, virus and election and stimulus. Are we getting it? Are we not getting it? So we're going to be talking about a host of things that are coming our way, which none of us can even predict because I am not a Nostradamus. So thanks for watching. Tune in tomorrow. Until then, stay forever money blessed. And do remember, you are only one deal away.